Rock on.
Hi, we have a few people who weren't here yesterday. Anybody want to try to kind of explain in like a real quick sentence what it was about, Mr. Patton?
You aren't really you.
You aren't really you. That's an interesting way of describing it.
It's basically the ego inside your mind are the thoughts that you have that basically stick with you and kind of bug you. And the idea behind what he was teaching us was that when you have a moment where you're like up late and your mind is telling you all these different things about yourself that are bad about yourself or that are negative, or you're thinking about something somebody said to you once like years ago, that's not you, what's called your ego trying to belittle you and bring you down, but you cannot identify as that because you are yourself as an individual and not the thoughts that get shot up in your mind, basically.
That's a long sentence, but that won't work. No, that's a good... Are you going to say something?
Yeah, your thoughts don't define you.
Your thoughts don't define you. Fair enough. Okay. And we spent a bunch of time talking about like where your thoughts come from and where do they come from. A lifetime of conditioning. What is conditioning? That's everything you've ever experienced. So the family you were raised in, what you were told by your mom or dad or siblings or friends, what you observed in the media, what you got from society. All of those things, all of those forces have made you into what you are today. What you are today is what Eastern philosophy calls the egoic mind, meaning you think you're all of that. So we'll get into it. So part of this, slightly repetitive yesterday, but I changed some slides. So Eastern philosophy just says you've been fooled by the illusion called the egoic mind. And so here's a picture. It's just a basic picture, but you can look at it two different ways. Does anybody see the two different pictures in that picture?
Yes.
Does anybody only see one picture? Be honest.
Okay. Oh, never mind.
So the idea is you're all looking at the same picture. Some of you see that there's two people. This guy's playing a flute. This lady's behind. It's a water scene. Okay. Maybe others happen to see that also there's a guy there. There's an eye. There's an eye. There's a head. There's a mouth. There's a chin. You basically, if you all of a sudden were to see the second picture, looking at the same life you've looked at, and all of a sudden you look at it slightly different, it's a difference of perception. You perceive life differently. So what the egoic mind says is you've been fooled because you think this picture is only two people. They're saying there's something beyond that. And so that's what we got into yesterday. Once again, Eastern philosophy says you are not your thoughts. Your thoughts come from your mind, and your mind was formed by society. And all of the stuff you've ever interacted with, it's made you who you are today. So this slide might help. So let's actually look at how you became who you are. It's a basic question. Let me ask Mr. Matt, how did you become who you are? What made you who you are?
Well, there's not just like one event.
What events, experiences made you who you are? That's what I'm looking for in general. Besides experiences, what else made you who you are? Anybody? What made you who you are? Poetry?
Expectation from society and how society see you as a person.
Okay. Society's expectation, that's a big thing. What else makes you who you are? Go ahead.
Your parents, how you were raised.
How you were raised. Those are all fair and true. Here's the issue. Let's break down the sentence. How you became who you are. Eastern philosophy says that's two different things there, two different people, and that's sort of the observation that you might see when you look at the picture differently. If you break down the sentence, how you became who you are, that first you is your awareness, your soul, if you believe in that, your life force, your uncarved block. The phrase is Wu Wei if you're a Taoist. You may remember the phrase blank slate. In other words, whatever it is, when you're first born, you were raised in this town by your parents, in this society, in this age, and you became who you are today. If you were raised by different parents in a different society at a different time, would you be a different person?
Yes.
The issue is, the fact that you could change who you are means that the first you is who you are before everything begins to affect you, before society has its forces upon you. So you are an uncarved block. We'll do yin-yang later on with the Taoism. So the second you, how you became who you are, the second you is the ego, as I described it yesterday. That's what you've become. That's the mask that you've been taught to wear. And perhaps you've now confused the mask that society has put upon you with who you really are. So there's a quote. Ego says, once everything falls into place, I will find peace. Spirit says, find peace and everything will fall into itself. Remember, the ego is the I that you have to protect. So in essence, the first you, that's the unclouded block, you're conditioned by family, society. You learn, this is the big thing, a lot, some of you know this, you learn what is expected from you in love and attention. So you're a little kid and you naturally want to be part of sort of the mother, father, careful, there's a camera over there, not to knock it over so much. Just sit next to Frank if you would be so kind, sir. The issue is, as a young child, you love your mother, you love your father, you're not really sure why, and you do something, and your parents, oh my God, you're so cute, look how you did that, and they give you a pat on the head, they give you a hug, they give you an ice cream sandwich. You begin to be conditioned, I do this thing, and I'm loved, and you want to do more of that thing. And all of society, when you have friend groups, you become, how many of you have changed as a person since you've been in high school? You've changed because you have learned and you've adapted to what is expected of you, or maybe you've shed what was expected of you and the real you has come out. We're talking about something called the egoic mind there, Jack. It's
like ego?
Yeah. But it's different than ego.
But like egoic.
So, the second you is the ego that's created by the first you. It's where your thoughts come from, is this mask. And most of us go, Jack, I'll ask you, actually, let me go with somebody else. Jack, or who else wasn't here? Is it Gavin? Who else wasn't here? Putri, Jake? Are you guys ever, the four of you, are you ever just like pummeled by your thoughts and you wish you weren't so much? Like, in other words, sometimes you use your thinking like as a tool and you're like, oh, I want to remember this or I want to figure this out, and the brain is useful, the mind is useful. But do you ever have times where your brain, your mind just won't shut up and it keeps filling you full of thoughts and you wish it would? This whole presentation is to try to change that in the Eastern perspective. So, we talked about this yesterday, your ego has all of these concepts. It's what you like, what you dislike, your opinions on things, who you really dislike, your long resentments. This is the big one. You generally will accept yourself as success or a failure because you look at how you're viewed in society. I'll give you an example. Let's say that Jack, you are the smartest person at Plainfield High School. I'm not saying that's true, I'm just saying you are. In your mind, you're the smartest, and you, because you're the smartest, you look at everybody else, whether you realize it or not, whether you're the smartest or the best player or the best musician or the best artist or whatever it is, that defines in your brain who you are. You think to yourself, I'm smarter than them, I'm more than them. Here's the question, you're the same intellect, you go to a college and now you're not the smartest, somehow you're a college full of Stephen Hawking juniors, now you're the dumbest. Except you're the same level of intelligence. Will you potentially, maybe not you, but in general, would you start to look at yourself differently as you compare yourself with everybody else?
Yeah.
So the idea of this whole thing, Marvin, the idea of this whole thing is by comparing yourself to others and either being a more than or a less than in every criteria, that's who you think you are and it's not. So, we did this yesterday. Any sentence you ever give, there's an I involved. They call it, Eastern philosophy calls it the I, me, my sort of experience, where we're always thinking about I. Here's a quote, let's skip that. So the idea is, your thoughts or stories made up by your ego, which is who you think you are, as soon as you realize that you're aware of your thoughts as they come into your head, but you're not thinking the thoughts to generate them. Let me explain it differently. Are you the thoughts, or are you observing the thought as it comes to you? Are you, when you're sitting there and you're being pummeled by your own brain, so whatever the top 10 list of things that bother you most about life, it's playing, that those songs are playing. So, oh my God, how am I going to pay for college? What am I going to do with my life? Why did I ever do that back when I was 12? Whatever they are, those questions, those thoughts that come into your head, are you actively going, let me remember everything that bothers me? Or do those things come to you and you just observe them? Eastern philosophy says, as soon as you realize that all you are is the observer, every minute Every second of every day, there are 1,000 stimuluses going on. I'm teaching, if you listen, there's a sound coming from there. The clock's ticking. He was making the sound with the foot. You don't hear all of those things, right? Out of your corner of your eyes, you see peripheral motion. Those are all stimuluses, and you tend to focus on one or focus on another. Yes, sir.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir. The issue is, Eastern philosophy says that your thought is just another stimulus. When you realize that you're not thinking the thought is coming to you, and then what you often do, then you jump onto it, and then you think about the thought that came to you, and then it takes you down a road where you're going to want to beat yourself in the head with a hammer. Who knows what I'm talking about? Did you think it the first time when it came into your thought this evening? If you ask yourself, am I generating a thought or am I observing the thought that occurs, you'll realize you are not your thoughts. So here's the scenario. Actually, I'll talk about that later. This is Alan Watts. I think you read some Alan Watts, right? From Tori, he's a big Alan Watts fan. So waking up to who you really are requires letting go of who you imagine yourself to be. As soon as you realize who you really are, you're more comfortable in the present moment. All right, so here we go. You ready? Are you conditioned or taught by society, to get all your attention back, are you taught by your society to always compare everything without realizing it?
Yeah.
Even to the extent you compare every moment that happens, every event that happens, you compare it to, without saying it, you think, well, if I was in charge, it would never happen like this. So when it's raining, or when something bad happens, you'll think, or something good happens, oh, that's not right how they did that over there, or, oh, I wish it wasn't raining today, or it's just not fair how they got the scholarship and I didn't. We have to say, whatever it is, you always question what is. You compare what is to what you think it should be. Fair to say?
Yeah.
I know you'd know this, but it's kind of like wishing a dog could meow. It's never going to happen. You're never going to change what is. And so what happens is, you are conditioned on a deep level in your childhood. Comparing is how I get value. I'm good because people like me, or I'm good because I'm good at soccer, or whatever it is. Or I'm awful because nobody calls me up. Other people get phone calls, why don't I? You compare yourself. Now when you compare what happens in life to how, in your mind, I would never have it that way, then you become uneasy in any moment, which causes you to do what? You become dissatisfied. How many of you in your senior year, your final year of schooling in this town, at times find yourself with a lot of unease or dis-ease? Only one person, wow. My other class, everybody raised their hand. This class, you guys are all happy kids, awesome. Now, just moments of like, what am I gonna do? Like, what's gonna happen in college or whatever it is? Here's what Eastern philosophy says. They say, when you compare every moment that happens, and you have an expectation of what it should be, and it's not that, you'll never be happy in the moment, which is why your mind in a moment always sits about thinking about the past regrets or fearing the future problems. And then what you do is, because you can't be happy in this moment right now, you look forward to the future where everything's gonna be great. Because isn't it gonna be awesome when I'm not surrounded by all these kids in Plainfield? I can't wait till I graduate, and then everybody's gonna be awesome, and I can't wait till that happens, and then you're gonna say that to yourself now, and it makes now okay, because you're not gonna be living in this forever. In the future, it's gonna be so much better. And then you're gonna get to the future, and what's gonna happen?
Just miserable.
It's gonna be exactly the way you thought it was going to be?
No.
No, it's gonna be exactly the way it is, which is the exact same situation as before. But then you'll say, well, I can't wait till I leave college, because then I'll be able to. And we'll always look to the future, because we can never become content with the present. That makes sense? And it's because the present's not good enough, because you and your mind compare how, if I was in charge of nature, it would be different. It would be fair. That's sort of the concept behind this. This is what I was just saying. In our country, we're always in the process of becoming. We're never actually being. You're always thinking what you're going to be, or a kid in the class said, I can't wait till I graduate from grad school, because then I can become a doctor, and I can help everybody in the world, and then when I retire at 65, then I can have fun and travel the world. And I was thinking, okay, so you're waiting until you're 65 to actually let your hair down and enjoy things. This is what I said, not having enough in the moment. future expectations. We romanticize the future. Anybody kind of like look forward to the future, like, oh, it's going to be awesome.
Oh yeah.
I would argue what you're doing is you're just setting yourself up for future suffering. Because, go ahead.
It just depends on the circumstance of what you're looking forward to.
What are you looking forward to?
Like right now?
Yeah.
Leaving school early.
Why?
Why? Because school sucks.
Okay, so you're not happy with this present moment. It's
well,
not,
no, I'm happy with what I'm doing right now, but... I mean,
school in general, this present moment, not this very moment, but like this
school
year.
School in general just
okay.
is slow and obnoxious.
And next year, what's it going to be like?
Oh, it's going to be hell for me, anyway.
Bless you.
And I just have to deal with it.
Okay, and you're looking forward to that challenge.
Yes, I am.
Okay. Is there a chance, perhaps, that your expectations aren't going to come? I guarantee
oh, yeah.
it will be hell, but...
Yeah.
If you're always not happy with now, and you're always thinking about tomorrow, and if tomorrow never comes, you're always chasing your tail, and that's sort of the Eastern philosophy says, just embrace whatever happens in the present, and then you don't have to look towards the future, because the only thing that really exists is now. Is there a future? Is there a past?
We've already been over this.
That's what I'm saying. I'm going back to
yeah.
it. The question is, all there really is right now,
exactly.
and it might happen in the past, it might happen in the future. You need to accept whatever is now in order to get any satisfaction. Here's the issue. A lot of you know this. Who can ever get into the zone? You're playing basketball, you're playing music, you're singing, you're doing poetry. Who knows what I'm talking about, where you're not thinking of anything else, and you're, are you happy in that moment? You're truly at peace. You're not worried about the laundry or the college bill or whatever it is. When you really break down why it's so good in that moment, it's because you're not doing what? You're not thinking about the thoughts that are generated by your ego. You're just acting.
Pretty much turn into an animal.
Well, I don't know if you turn into an animal.
Not
or maybe,
an animal.
Maybe just the real you comes out and the stimulus of your thoughts isn't as loud at that moment because
yeah.
you're embracing the now. Okay, let me show you the little quick video. It's about 5 minutes long. It kind of summarizes everything. Some of what I said came from this guy named Eckhart Tolle. He's a philosopher today. This video is about 5 minutes long. It kind of summarizes what I said. He talks kind of fast. This is during a actual speech. There's some other video stuff they're going to show. He didn't make the video. He talked and somebody turned it into a video. But actually listen, especially if you haven't gotten what I've said so far or you weren't here, this stuff might kind of make it clear.
There's no ego apart from the thoughts. The thoughts, identification with thoughts, is ego. But the thoughts that go through your mind, of course, are linked to the collective mind of the culture you live in, humanity as a whole. So they are not your thoughts as such, but you pick them up from the collective, most of them. And so you identify with thinking, and the identification with thinking becomes ego, which means simply that you believe in every thought that arises, and you derive your sense of who you are from what your mind is telling you who you are. Opinions, viewpoints of that's me, that's some people talk to themselves and you are, oh, you are so good. Why doesn't the world recognize you? Or the mind says, you're no good. Same thing. You're no good at all. You fail at everything, don't you? Again, and then you believe in it. And then you suddenly have a low view of yourself. Why you have a low view? Because you believed in your thoughts. And why are you thinking those thoughts? Probably you picked them up somewhere, maybe in childhood, maybe your mom was so stressed out that you said you're no good, and so you pick up certain thoughts and they get stuck in your head. Thoughts that you hear in childhood, they're little energy forms, like entities, and they get stuck in your head and don't refuse to go. They go. And the more you believe in it, the more lodged, more deeply lodged they become in your mind. And so some people are stuck with very hostile entities. I'm saying entity, not in some spooky way, but every thought is an energy form, and as such we could call it an entity. And there are many people in this world who are stuck with hostile, life-denying, continuously critical and attacking entities that they carry in their head, and they believe that is who they are. And they are continuously attacking themselves. And if they are not attacking themselves, they attack others around them. Let me tell you who you are. Of course, what they're really saying is, let me tell you who I am. So they project the famous, you know the famous saying, we don't see things as they are, we see them as we are. Which means you look at reality through the screen of your thinking and your judgment, which is conditioned by the past. A dreadful present to live in. It's like blinkers, worse than blinkers. It's like looking at reality through heavy veils. So the identification with thinking, believing in your thoughts, having no space outside of the movement of thought. Again, here we come to the final thing, lack of space inside. That is the unconscious condition, spiritually, completely unconscious. And then you are burdened with a heavy ego. You are the ego, which is not as an entity apart from thought. It is thoughts that you have identified with. And the first moment of freedom comes when you realize that certain thoughts have been going through your head for years, perhaps, and that they are only thoughts, and that you are not the thought, you're the awareness. Everybody's life, things, in daily life, things go wrong, you miss a bus, you get stuck in a traffic jam, or you lose some money. But yes, this is normal, but if you have the thought, bad things always happen to me, you're extremely aware of those things, and they confirm to you that the thought is correct. And this is the selective perception of reality through the screen of thinking. So the reality will confirm to you, and not only that, that thought or any thought of that kind actually attracts bad things, negative things. So freedom comes from stepping out, encountering, first of all, a little bit of space inside your presence. And then from there you realize certain thoughts as repetitive and just a thought. Bad things always happen to me. Oh, there it goes again. I just thought that before. So that's the, to become free of ego means becoming free of thought, identification with thought. That's the end of the ego. It may reassert itself from time to time, but at least that's the awakening.
Okay. Thoughts.
Sound like a robot.
He sounds like a robot. That's what we were thinking during that. Okay. You guys follow on that, or disagree with that, or agree with that? Needs feedback. Thank you, Derek.
So, I feel like we've been kind of just focusing on, like, negative things that, like the ego, if our thoughts are negative and stuff, and that we tell ourselves that's not who we are, and, like, basically this whole thing is about our thoughts not being who we actually are.
Okay.
But, like, what if they're actually, like, good thoughts?
That's
like,
also not who you are. Remember we said yesterday it's more than or less than? Well, here's the thing. If you think, oh, I'm so good at softball, I'm the best softball player, aren't I great? That's awesome. Right? Or if you think I'm the worst softball player, this is miserable, that's terrible. But the question is, rather than having to be more than somebody or less than somebody in all criteria, instead of comparing yourself to everybody all the time like you've been trained to, can't you just accept that who you are is perfect as you are, and the soul you are, the person that you are, is the person that you are? You don't have to be positive in terms of all the traits you have, or negative. It's beyond that. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's kind of like why there's a kid in my class who loves compliments. And if you give them a compliment, like, oh, thank you so much, and they're so happy. How many of you love compliments? Only a few of you. All of you, the rest of you hate compliments. Okay. You like when you get a compliment. Why? Because somebody else is saying, nice job. That's awesome. And you're like, yeah. And you're like, yeah, hell yeah, I got a compliment. Well, here's the question. Those of you who like compliments, put your hands back up, who like compliments. Do you dislike when you get criticized?
No,
not as much. Hypothetically, Mariah, if you really love compliments, you're allowing other people to control whether or not you're happy, control whether or not you have value. And if you hate criticism, it's because you listen to what other people say and it defines who you are, rather than just being established in who you are. So, do you want to know how to stop this process?
Yes.
The whole first part of the day, or yesterday, if I did the right PowerPoint, was whether or not, this is what the Eastern philosophy believes, the egoic mind, and then it gave you lots of examples of like how the egoic mind works. How many of you recognize some of your activities as being included in that? Being like, you like complaining, or you like bragging, or you like gloating, or you like to tell me. A lot of people, some of the other class was like, I recognize every single one of those as mine. So, three-step process. Step number one, here's what the Eastern philosophy believes, the egoic mind. Step number two, is this in myself? Step number three, well, who does it affect and how to fix it? Well, I would say it most affects two types of people. One type of people it affects are your super successful people. Some of you are in this room. Super successful people, meaning you've done really well at whatever it is you're trying to do well at. You've realized that life and how you're viewed by life is established by how others view you. You following that? In other words, you're going, ooh, in school, the thing that makes me better than others is I get better grades. So you're comparing yourself to others. And you said, I need to be the best. And you drive yourself to be the best because you want to have value because you're comparing yourself to all these idiots who are sitting around. That's one type of person who has this. The other type of person is the completely unsuccessful person who lets it sort of beat them over the head. They go, oh, life never works out for me. And then they hear that. And then every time something like that happens, it reinforces their belief. So does it affect everybody? Yes. There's three ways you can actually get around this, three techniques. And all I would say is try it. I don't know if this works. I've tried it. Maybe it works for you, maybe it doesn't. So here's the thing. Next time you're having one of those negative thought sort of, hey Marvin, stand up please. Next time you're having one of those negative thought processes, how many of you get them almost every day where your mind just won't shut up? Only a couple of you, a few of you, okay, a lot of people. Just do this. Now, it's unfortunate because somebody already wrote me a journal and was like, I've already tried it and it's already working and this is amazing sort of thing. So here's what you do. Three things you could do. Actually, I have a little... Let me just show you the slide. So, first thing is something called cultivating the witness, creating the space through understanding. So that's what I've tried to do so far. What does that mean? If you understand that you're not your thoughts are made by everything you've ever lived through and experienced. It's a mask you're wearing. If you understand that, become the witness. Now what's the witness? The witness is next time you're having, and you can literally try this next period or tonight or whenever, next time you're stuck in that repetitive negative thought process, think to yourself, am I hearing these thoughts? Am I witnessing these thoughts? Am I separate from these thoughts? If you're sitting there going, oh, I can't, I hate, and you're just worrying, and you're actively doing it. But the first thought that comes wasn't you. When you realize that you're the witness, when you create some separation, some space, it's a weird sort of like this mindset, it's a perspective. Kind of like that picture, you could see it in two different ways. Next time you start having a negative thought, just kind of go, it's kind of weird how this is happening, but I'm observing it happening. The thought is coming to me, and I'm observing it. Now, what this does is two things. Number one, it puts you into the moment. Because instead of, oh my God, I'm in science class, but yet I hate science class, and here comes that what am I going to do about college thought. If all of a sudden it starts beating you over the head with like a hammer, go, wait a minute, am I hearing this thought? And when you become conscious of how you're thinking, it snaps you out of it, and then you realize every time you do it, if you snap yourself back into the present and go, well, I'm just observing this thought, I'm just witnessing the thought, then what happens, it's really odd, the thoughts tend not to come as often. It happens over time, but if you just get in the habit, as soon as that negative thought comes, you go, oh, no, there it is again. I'm just observing something that's happened. It's like a stimulus. It's like a fire alarm. Oh, going off again. Or not a fire alarm. It's like a morning alarm to wake you up. Well, there it is again. You're not the alarm. You hear the alarm, and then you turn the alarm off. The thoughts are sort of the same thing. By realizing you're not the thought through understanding. The second one is labeling of your thoughts. I was taught this by a teacher. It worked for me. I also use it for meditation. Labeling your thoughts means is this. If you had to, could you take your negative thoughts and put them into certain classifications, like fear of my future well-being, or inadequate self, like I'm inadequate, I'm not good looking enough, or I don't have a nice enough, whatever they are, make classifications. Then when you're sitting there in that moment, and you're in, you know, my class, or you're driving somewhere, or you're at dinner table, and all of a sudden you get whatever thought it is, that first thought that pops in your head isn't your thought, label it. So, there it is. Yep, it's me once again worrying about the future. When you start labeling the way you think, once again, you're conscious in the moment, and once again, the thoughts will kind of go away. And the third one, which is kind of the same thing, just have that self-inquiry. Actually question, am I these thoughts, or am I the one observing the thoughts? It might be different from you than me. I can't tell you for certain. I look at it a certain way. And now when I have lots of negative thoughts. They never go away, but you begin to control them. All you can do is change how quickly they come and how long they stay for. Does that make sense? How quickly they come. I don't get them that often. Sometimes I do. Sometimes I think, ooh, this isn't enough, or I wish I was more like, or whatever it is. And then I do my little labeling. I know that I'm the witness to what I'm thinking. I'm not the one thinking it, unless I start thinking about it. And then when you start thinking about it, what happens? That's you beating yourself over your head. So when the thought first comes, just go, there it is again. Now, there is one of the fathers of Zen in America was a guy named Roshi Suzuki. His quote was about thoughts. He says, leave your front door and back door open. Allow your thoughts to come and go, just don't serve them tea. Meaning, if you try meditation, it's like, what is meditation? Not thinking, right? But you can't not think. Thoughts are going to come. If you resist the thought, it doesn't work. It's basically going to bang down the door. Leave the door open, the thought comes in, and go, oh, there it is again, me, you know, negative about this or that, and then it tends just to leave. Alan Watts, another Zen philosopher, said, muddy water is best cleared by just leaving it alone. Muddy water is best cleared by leaving it alone. So in other words, when you have that negative thought, if you decide to jump onto it and ride it for the next 3 hours of misery, rock ahead. But if you actually go, I'm just observing it, there it is, it kind of drifts away. Thoughts. Yes, sir. I want to do a little bit of a discussion. Yeah, I've been talking for a period and a half now.
We read a book recently in our English and fiction class where it was about like a wrongfully convicted person who was sent to jail.
Okay.
He turned to Zen Buddhism when
yep.
he was in jail.
Yep.
And he talked about, for him, whenever he did do meditation, he didn't really ever discuss anything like this. He was more of like a different kind of like
yep.
Buddhist.
Yep.
But for him, he would basically meditate. He would allow his mind to venture out, and then he would forget where he was for a while because he would let his mind wander. And then when he came back, then because he was in such a sensory deprived room, he would like actually just like forget like, oh, what is even like reality at this point?
Okay, well that's a different way of doing it. I'm not saying any way is right. Whatever works for the individual. I didn't really, what I do, honestly, I probably every day I get 4 or 5 different bouts of here comes the negative thought, whatever it is. And I actually make a joke about it. I'm like, oh, here's my old bastard friend coming back to bug me again. And just by making a joke out of it, it tends to leave. Because I'm not thinking about the thought. I see the thought, and I just kind of go off with you. And every once in a while, I mean, it's not like, there's a philosopher named Ram Dass who says, like, you guys know what neurosis is? Neurosis? Neurosis is like this, the sort of messed up things in your character that you do that you wish you didn't have to do. Everybody has them. All of this stuff, he said, doesn't make your neuroses go away. It just makes them a little tiny. And you can bring them out like your family of neuroses. Here's my family of neuroses, and bring them out. But now they're minimized. Now they're smaller. Now they don't rule you. You rule them. They're still there. There will still be moments where you get caught and like, oh, I'm doing it again. And maybe sometimes you can't get out of whatever stuff you're stuck in. But ultimately, you realize over practice, one kid said they're already doing it yesterday. They wrote me a journal midday, and I was like, oh my God, this actually works. Because I just said, oh, it's not me talking. Why am I even thinking this? And then it went away. So I don't know. Try it for yourself. Some of you aren't getting it because you don't need to get it yet. Because your lives are perfect, you're happy, and you're not looking for anything. For some reason, I don't know why this is, the people who are most prone to hearing it are the people who are open-minded or have an open heart. And by open heart, the way you get an open heart usually is by suffering, by going through some stuff. So the old mantra, It's a Sanskrit mantra, and it says, it was like, you repeat it over and over again, and they said, let wisdom be placed upon my chest. You say it five times. Let wisdom be placed upon my chest. Let wisdom, and after the fifth time, let wisdom be placed upon my chest so that when my heart breaks, the wisdom can seep in. Because a lot of times, only when you go through some stuff are you then open-minded to hear different observations. I was reading the few journals I got. Some of them were like, wow, this really works. Some was like, I don't even know what you're talking about. Some of them were like, I already know this. I know I have an ego, but who cares? I'm not making you try to change at all. You don't have to change at all. This is just their particular theory. I need you to write journals so I know if you get it or if it's usable, because I don't know if this stuff can be taught in America in high school. I just don't know if it. I think it can. I think some people, if five people get something out of it, awesome. It's worth it, because I know it changes how you look at things. Comments? Hooter.
I have that type of moment where like I'm so stressed of something, but then I just snap back and like, why am I even like worrying about it? I don't know. Then suddenly I start laughing. I was like, why am I even like stressing about it? It doesn't really matter. And like in the end, like those stress is how. So how do I see it? It's like you separate yourself from the Maya thinking. You understand, right? When I'm
yeah,
thinking.
No, that's.
So like you separate yourself from my thinking, so you have like two different sounds weird. You have two different minds. You have two different lives.
That's what we've been talking about.
Yeah.
The difference between the egoic mind and you, which is the observer, which is the person you are.
Yeah. And like how I was raised is that there's two. There's like the my life is like the handphone, internet, anything, friends, and then there's another you, which like you are. So it's like.
Now you are a Hindu.
I am.
And you were raised in Advaita Vedanta, which is a type of Hinduism, which is what we're talking about. Eastern philosophy is Zen Buddhism, and Advaita Vedanta believes this stuff 100%. Then Buddhism and Taoism and other Eastern philosophies believe it to a lesser extent. But for whatever reason, in our country and in Europe, it's very much one mind and I'm that mind, and you were taught separation, and hypothetically it makes it easier to get through the day. I don't know if it does or not, but that's the theory about it.
It's easier to
yes, sir. Right,
but like either one of you, like once you like recognize that you have two different minds, like is it bad?
You don't have two different minds.
No, okay, no, I don't know, but like what she's saying, how like there's one part of you, like is it bad to keep both of those, or like are you supposed to just get rid of one?
The issue is this, you're not getting rid of anything. In fact, what's happened is the egoic mind has completely drowned out who you are. Mm-hmm. You think who you are is based on all the comparison you've made to one another, and you've been developing that your whole life. You're never going to get rid of your ego. But what you want to do, and this is important, good question. You want to try to, if it's a problem for you, you want to minimize your ego. Because by minimizing your ego, making it less than it was before, you're no longer going to be affected by everything that's ever said to you, positive or negative. The real you, unconditioned, begins to come out. Now, I actually went and I took some pieces of journals people wrote last night and I put them on a PowerPoint to show, which I'll probably show tomorrow. But questions like that are good. You're never going to get rid of your ego, and you don't want to. But the issue is your ego has completely drowned out the other thing. If you can, if there's one thing you can get out of this, if you can, in that moment of fear, insecurity, anger, whatever it is where your mind is torturing you, if you can realize, wow, this is my ego talking. It's not me. My ego has been developed over my 17 years by my interaction with society. But my interaction with society has made the ego. Therefore, the ego is not me because I interacted with society to make it. When you realize there's a separation, when you become the witness to what the ego is thinking.
And you start to reverse that process.
Now, you don't want to be, I'm not, you were raised in it. I've been doing it about 10 years. I can't say that I am a different person, but I'm not that much of a different person. I still have an ego. Give you a quick story. I still have an ego, and I catch myself. So I'm big into music collecting. I think I've told you that before.
Yeah.
And so there's a website. It's a big-time website. Thousands of people go to it. And the guy who's on the website sent me an email and said, you're one of our better members. Could you become the curator for the week? And I was like, ooh. What that means is I get to pick five songs that I think are really good and put them on the, I give them to him and he puts them on the website. So I just picked five weird songs that nobody had ever really probably heard before. I sent them to him, he put them up there, and then every day when I go home, one of the first things I do when I go on the computer, I go to that website and see how many people have listened to the songs. I did it last night, I came home, and one of the songs, about 30,000 people have listened to the songs in the first week. I've had them up there. And people write comments, and most of the comments are good. And every day I go and check, because part of me's like, yeah, look at that. 30,000 people listen to something I put up there. Ooh, isn't it awesome, the great thing they wrote? And then, here's the thing, when it happens, I go, ooh, look what I'm doing. Rather than just, I share music, or music's being shared, I'm thinking how great I am, because everybody's looking up to me. You never get rid of it, but when you recognize that it exists, the negative side of it goes away. Mr. Pepin and then Christian.
Well, I was gonna go talk about those things there when
yep.
those thoughts come into my head. I pretty much look at everything as like a glass half full standpoint.
Okay.
And put things into a humorous standpoint so I can just laugh right through the bad things and
okay.
just glide right over them like nothing happened.
But you, Mr. Pepin, as everybody as well, mm-hmm. I don't know if you see this in yourself. Oh, by the way, what I'm going to do right now is bad. Don't do it. Because one thing you'll be able to do if you actually paid attention during this class, you'll be really, and Cassandra, you've noticed this already before we even had this discussion, you begin to notice the ego in other people.
Yep.
How many of you can see when the ego is making other people powering them? And it makes you kind of like, you know what happens? As soon as you do that, you become superior to them because you know why they think so messed up. And once again, in doing so, you've just made your ego stronger. You just made your ego stronger because ultimately what you're doing is, oh, look how stupid they are and what they're doing. It's their stupid ego. And in doing so, you're judging them and you're causing it. There's something called spiritual materialism whereby you think you have powers because you can see it in others. I think you can see it in others. Here's the question, Mr. Pepper. Can you see it in yourself?
I do see that.
Because I see it in you.
I see it in you.
I'll give you an example. The day, whoever it was, it may have been Seth, made some comment to you, and you said, the first thing, if you don't agree with me, then you're just stupid.
Yeah.
That's what you said. Because what happened was, him not agreeing with you wasn't him not agreeing with your idea. You became defensive of you.
Yeah.
And you threw that out. You're more intelligent than that comment.
Yeah.
That was your ego talking. So that it's easy to see it in others, and you probably can see it in me as well.
Yeah.
I can't see it in Putri that much. And Putri, we didn't even talk about it. I have her in another class, but she recognizes we have this bond. It's like some sort of weird, no, we do. There's a mindset. You mentioned it, right?
Yeah.
There's some mindset, because I happen to think in a way that's similar to how she was raised thinking, and nobody else really around here has, so it's a different mindset. Christian.
So I was going to say, I don't necessarily agree with like any of this.
That's fine.
I don't personally believe, I don't know if anyone agrees with me, that living in the now and rejecting your ego is a good thing.
You don't think it's a good thing? Why?
Because, your ego is kind of what makes you push further. If you block out your ego, it kind of stunts your growth. And, I've been reading a lot of Ayn Rand, so... When it comes to your ego, it really is just your conscience. It's just you.
Is it your conscience, or is it what society has made and has become your conscience?
The ego, a lot of this is about making yourself happy making peace with yourself, but
yep.
As soon as you please your ego, you please yourself. I mean, you can deny it all you want, but it's the truth.
But, okay, the rationale behind it, I'll give you an example, for me as a teacher, am I teaching because I want to have lots of compliments and I want to be teacher of the millennium? Or am I teaching because I want to share stuff to help others? That's a small change. Now, me personally, I'm going back to your thing, I don't become complacent. I work harder now than I did before because my reason for it isn't to please myself. I think it's what I was designed to do.
I think in some way you're pleasing yourself, though, because you know that you're helping all these kids.
Only you can address how you're affected by it. Some people are going to be a surgeon to help. Like one kid wants to do, I think it's, wants to do plastic surgery for children. Like people who've been like disfigured.
Oh, okay.
Now, if you're doing that because you want to be the doctor and have everybody look at you like, oh, look how, isn't she great? That's one thing. But if you actually look at it like, I want to help all of these poor children and help them, that's the difference. Helping the poor children isn't about your ego.
You're pleasing that need to want to, help people, though. So
to some degree.
Either way, it's...
Well, the question is whether or not it's a need or whether or not it's a drive. I would say I still have ambition to teach, and I don't do it through a selfish reason. I don't mean this disrespectfully, but I don't really care what you guys think about me. I care about what you think about the material. I do the best I can, and that's all I can do. And if you guys like it, awesome. If you don't, that's unfortunate. I want you to, but it doesn't. Right, I do the best I can.
I think we look at the word selfish as like a bad thing, but I think you'd be good to.
I don't disagree with you.
I mean, a lot of these people, I'm sure, come from predicaments where they're not necessarily the richest. So they're like, you know, money doesn't matter, man, blah, blah, blah. But if you come to America, I mean, it's the land of the free, but it's also the land of competition. I mean, everybody's competing like 24/7. There is no stop.
There could be no bigger difference than Eastern philosophy and Ayn Rand. And if you live under Ayn Rand, awesome. I'm just expressing what this is.
Yeah.
And different people, it's an old line, it's a box of rain. Use it if you need it, if not, pass it along. In other words, if you don't need it, that's fine. It's just throwing it. And if you guys disagree, that'll be good for some discussion.
Yeah, I don't agree.
We're going to continue the discussion tomorrow. I'm going to have you read something as well tomorrow. Go ahead.
I was thinking about, when I was thinking about this, I would like to, kind of put this into, practice. But at the same time, I feel like if I get rid of my ego, I'm not going to want to do the things that I do. Like, I'm not going to have my ambition anymore. And that's,
you know what?
That's why I'm worried about it. Yeah, because I don't know if getting rid of this ego or whatever that I please myself through doing well through things, if that's gonna make me be less of the ambitious person that I am.
Once again, remember, you'll never get rid of your ego, you'll just put it in check. So let me show you what somebody wrote. All right. Somebody wrote this in a journal last night. Okay? It said, honestly, I know maybe this isn't the best thing, but I love complaining, probably for a real selfish reason as well as a go-ish way, but I enjoy it. It makes me feel better in most cases because it lets me let out my frustrations and see if others can identify with what I'm saying. Okay? So that concept is, you feel better about yourself when you're complaining because you're able to see if anybody else agrees with what you're saying. There's nothing wrong with that. You can do that. But the issue is, ultimately, the same person wrote, I don't necessarily think the ego is bad or good, it's just there, maybe I'd be happier without it, but it's easier said than done. In response to that, here's Ram Dass. Ram Dass said, here's a question. We may ask how we could survive without our ego. Don't worry, it does not disappear. So you're not going to lose your ambition. You learn to venture beyond it. The ego is there as your servant. So in other words, the room is still there. You can always go in and use it like an office when you need to be efficient, but the door can be left open so you can always walk out. The ego will always be there. The question is whether or not it legislates every behavior you do. The question is, how many of you find a lot of examples of the ego sort of like torturing you? If you do, you would make adjustments. If not, you wouldn't. Other comments? Yes, sir.
I think I mentioned this to you, right, as we were leaving yesterday, but I don't really know. I don't necessarily agree with ego a lot.
Yeah.
But it's
with their theory.
Yeah, with their theory. Yep. But it's not that I don't agree with it as much as I just can't personally understand how I personally feel about it, because whenever I go to school, I have this weird feeling of like I'm just kind of going through the motions and just kind of like reacting to stimuli at school.
Yep.
And then there are like certain points where I become completely aware, and it's just kind of like, oh wow, and I gotta look around for a second, but then it immediately gets drowned out next block. I have to go back down to going to the motions, and I don't really think about much during school because you really can't. But then whenever I like sit at home, or if I'm like going somewhere and there's like music playing or something, that's when I become like really really aware, and it's really odd because. Like those are the moments where I don't necessarily. It's not necessarily like an ego talking to me and saying like negative or positive things.
Music is to the soul as words are to the mind.
Yeah.
So words make your mind go, oh yeah. But there's something about music that tends to soothe you for most people, and because it speaks to you on a deeper level than words ever could. I would say, I've said this concept before, this is definitely a time bomb teaching, meaning some of you get it right now and you're going to use it. Others of you, maybe 15 years from now, if you remember some aspect of this, all of a sudden it will mean something to you. When I read this stuff the first time, it was probably 25 years ago. And I went, oh, that's kind of neat. I wish I could do that. It's impossible to do that. I wish I could do it. And then about 10 years after that, I was in a position where I need to learn how to use this stuff. And then one day, the picture just came into focus. Let me go Cassandra first.
Actually, yesterday, I saw my old friend that I used to hang out all the time with go down, ride a bike down the road, and she was smoking. And she's younger than me, like a year younger than me.
Yep.
I was like, oh my gosh, if I continued hanging out with her, then my life would completely
potentially
be different.
You'd be a chain smoker.
Yeah.
Potentially.
Yeah.
In general, don't you notice that? Like, the friend groups you're in have shaped how you think.
That's
a you. That's who you are. But is that all you are? Or is there the witness that has changed? Jack.
Like what Sergio said, I like totally agree with that. Because, like, sometimes I feel myself thinking, like, when was the last time I actually had a conscious thought? Because, like Sergio said, like, especially at work, like, I will go through a 7-hour shift and just go through the motions. And, like, people are talking to me. And, like, I'm just doing stuff, and even, like, in school, or, like, working, like, on projects or anything like that, like, and even my whole life, like, I'll literally think to myself, like, after a couple of days, like, when was the last time I actually, like, thought to myself or had, like, a conscious thought or, like, actually used my brain? Because, like, I feel like I'll go through so long, just, like, responding to people, just, like, and I don't even know how I do it. Like, somebody will say something to me, and I'll respond without thinking. Like, I don't know how you do, like,
so
I don't know how I do that.
So here's the question. Do you, at times, have, like, deep conscious thoughts?
Yes, and I'll have, like, a conversation with myself in my head, and it's weird.
Okay, is that good or bad?
I feel like that's good, because that's when I feel like that's who I really am, and that's, like, me.
That's the issue.
Yeah.
The other, potentially, is the mask you live with your whole life, mm-hmm. and maybe the conscious moments is where the true you comes out. I don't know. It's going to vary according to the person. Ben, go ahead.
So, I'll be, like, going through that. I'll be, like, on the highway, and I'll be driving her house, which is, like, 45 minutes away.
Yeah.
And I'll just, like, I'll be at, like, exit, I don't know, 29, and then all of a sudden I'm at exit, like, 12.
Yeah.
And I'm like, did I just have a seizure? I don't remember anything.
People, you know what happens? You know where that happens at all? Well, for you guys, when you're supposed to read some book you don't want to read, your eyes saw the last 23 pages, but you don't know anything. Because here's the deal. This is the reason why this happens. Jack, this is the reason why it happens. You are so dissatisfied with that moment that your mind goes into daydream mode without realizing it. And rather than just, like, do the dishes, you're thinking about something else. And your mind will always, when it doesn't like the moment, it'll always think of a future moment. It's not gonna be this crappy. And we always just keep kicking the can down the road. As soon as you start embracing the moment, because you can accept the moment, because you realize the moment isn't who I am, it's just what I'm dealing with, things become a little different.
That definitely makes sense.
I think that also goes along with, like, how we're not actually supposed to think in school. We're actually supposed to just know what we're told and what we're supposed to do.
That's
just like at work, you're supposed to get taught a certain task, and you're supposed to do that simple, certain task, and you don't really think. You're just a brainless, just moving object, just doing...
I gave the example, I'm not going to retell it, unfortunately Jack missed it and a couple people missed it, but like that story about the dragon.
Yeah.
When you begin actually digging down of who and going deeper and deeper into yourself, it's painful but it's productive. And the fact is, you've been brainwashed just to regurgitate answers and never to think for yourself.
Yeah.
So when you start thinking of yourself, it's a weird sort of sensation.
Changes.
Only over time does it actually cause any changes.
But if you go through that, like all of a sudden I'm on group 12 or something.
Yep, yep.
You're not thinking of anything. So would that kind of function?
Tomorrow we'll pick up with that. Please write journals. I need journals.